So we were leaving off at this thing called statistical normative distribution. Let me get down to where we were. We talked about central tendency. We talked about the mean, the median, and the mode. The mode gives you some idea of what the most frequently occurring item is in your data set or variable or value in that variable. But it doesn't necessarily conform to the central tendency because you could have bimodal, trimodal distributions and things of that nature. It does tell you something, but the median gives you the center of the data. The mean can be very skewed if you got outliers, so it's very important to know the standard deviation. And I say, oh, there's that little symbol again. Standard deviation is what you want to know for your test. I'll say it as such on the test. Then you want to know these things here. And I'll reiterate them because we covered them already. The sample's representative of the population, whatever it is you're measuring, and you got a large enough sample, generally you need about an N of 30, higher the better, to approximate a normal distribution depending on what you're measuring. So you need a number of measurements or a number of participants, that's your N number. That one's pretty straightforward. Then your data should conform to a distribution that we call a normal distribution. It can be skewed though. Frequently it is skewed. So you ought to know a little bit about standard deviations to help you interpret data as a citizen, regardless of whether you go into a scientific field or not. Because it's important when people start spouting the mean without a standard deviation, you want to know this, and I'll show you why in just a sec. What you want to know for your test is 68% about, that's what these little squiggles mean, fit into the first plus or minus standard deviation. About 95% will fall into plus or minus second standard deviation, two standard deviations. And about 99.7% fall within plus or minus three standard deviations of the mean. So a standard deviation derived from the statistics, the variance, deviation, etc., gives us an idea of this thing here, spread of a data, variability in the data set. Percentage of the area under the curve, that's just what I told you. That's just a reiteration, a little graphic. You can draw one if you want. The mean will be in the middle for you, right? X bar, average, and then a minus one and a plus one. Inside of that, the blues on there are 68%, 68.26% of your measurements. The next one out, negative two standard deviations or positive two standard deviations from the mean, meaning you add the standard deviation to the mean twice, or you subtract it from the mean twice, you got 95.46% of your people falling in there. Then you get as far out as subtracting that standard deviation from the mean three times, or adding it to the mean three times, and now you got 99.73%, which still leaves roughly 0.3%. Now, in a small group of people, that's not going to occur, right? They're going to probably fall within the plus or minus three. But when you're talking about the nation or the world, you're talking about a lot of people falling into those outlier categories. These are some of the types of distributions you could see. You could see that a lot of the data are really grouped tightly around your mean, so that they don't deviate from the mean. You see what I'm saying? Deviation? They don't deviate a lot from the mean. You can see something more approximating this normal curve that we talk about in theory, or you can see something so spread out that there's so much spread in the data that the mean may not tell you what you think it tells you, because there's not a whole lot of people in that group right around the mean, because the group's so spread that there's a lot of people in multiple areas. Now, it's still going to conform to the plus and minus standard deviation rule, but the standard deviations might be way out here as opposed to tight to the mean down in here. So that gives you an idea. Now, I want to give you a more practical example. Again, I will always say be very careful when you're talking about IQ. In fact, we don't even talk about IQ anymore. That's intelligence quotient. We don't have an intelligence quotient anymore. But lay people don't know that. They call it IQ. Right? We talk about scores. Difference between a true score and an actual score on a test means something. Confidence intervals mean something. But we're talking about scores on a standardized test of intelligence, not IQ per se. What we're talking about usually when we're measuring that is academic ability to some degree, or academic capacity, if you will. That's one type of intelligence. As we'll get into that chapter, we'll talk about other theories of intelligence, like artistic intelligence, musical intelligence, spatial intelligence, sports or athletics intelligence. The people in the Winter Olympics, they're abnormally good at certain sports, right? In ways that I probably couldn't do even if I practiced, because they have some abilities, maybe inherent, but maybe developed. But they've developed those kinds of things. Interpersonal intelligence, the ability to know people and work with people, right? So this academic intelligence is just one metric, and don't be fooled into thinking that because somebody's got a high IQ that that makes them a good person, because Hitler was a bright person, right? It doesn't make him a good person any more than having a low IQ or low intelligence rating on a standardized measure makes you a bad person. Some of the coolest people I've ever met have low scores on this kind of measures, and some of the biggest asses I've ever met have high scores on these measures. So we tend to over-ascribe value to this thing called IQ. But let me give you a practical example where I think it's pertinent for your life. My daughter is a smart girl, and she was wondering in some political debate that we were having between us why other people just didn't see it as plain as she saw it, right? She's got a political persuasion, and she's like, well, I don't get it. It seems pretty obvious to me. The facts are these, and that's the way you ought to interpret them. Anybody that's, you know, able to understand it should be able to interpret it the way that I'm interpreting it, and people like me interpret it. And I said, well, there's a wonderful point, because you're making an assumption that everybody can understand it. You look at the normal curve, and what you find is for intelligence, on at least the Wechsler scale, the mean is 100. It's designed that way. So your average score is 100. Your standard deviation is 15, right? So what we see here is actual data. We've got 119,129 people that we've measured in this little data set, right? So we've got a representative sample. That's a real normal distribution if you ever will see one, right? Its mean is 100, but by definition, its standard deviation is 15, right? So if I go plus 15, I go up to 115, right? If the mean is 100, one standard deviation above the mean is 115. If I go one standard deviation below the mean, I'm at 85. Y'all got that, right? I mean, it's not that complicated. It sounds complicated and scary when we say standard deviation. Really, once you know the standard deviation and you know the mean, you now know a lot as a layperson, right? What I now know is that 68% of everybody has an IQ between 85 and 115. Are they equal in intellectual ability, 85 and 115? No, but they're normal. That is the normal range. In fact, if you go out one more standard deviation, now I'm adding 15 was the standard deviation to the mean twice, I'm at 130, right? If I subtract the mean from the mean, the standard deviation twice, I get down to 70. And that is actually still normal. It's a little above average. On this side of the curve, this purple group, it's a little below average on this side, right? But it's still in the normal clinical range. So now we figure out that, wow, 95% of people have an IQ, an intelligence score, if you will, between 70 and 130. They're not the same thing, and they don't imply human value, right? But the person that has a 70 thinks differently than the person with the 130. The ability to manipulate information mentally is an important ability. We value it in our society because it's really adaptive to be able to think about things abstractly, concretely, hypothetically, and work your way through information. So we do value it. It has practical implications. Then you get out here, and now I'm at 145. And down here, right, I'm at 55. Well, technically speaking, anybody that has a score on a standardized measure that is administered by a trained person who is usually licensed, I would hope, not always though, who's also got a score from somebody who knows how to score it appropriately and knows how to interpret it, right? If they have a score below 70, where the confidence interval might actually take them over 70, and you got to be mindful of that, and people who aren't trained typically aren't mindful. They go, oh, you got a 65. But if the confidence interval is 10, right, then that could mean their true score is as low as 60 or as high as 70. Now we're on the edge again. Depends on the circumstances under which they took the test. And we'll talk about that in a whole nother chapter. But work with me for a minute. People who are under this 70, clearly, and who also have deficits in daily living, meaning things that are hard for them to do are things that most people take for granted. Paying bills, for example. Reading signs that are important to understand, right? Holding a job. If they have problems with daily living and they're under a 70, they would be technically mentally retarded. That's a clinical term, not some kind of epithet to throw at people. It's not an insult. Oh, you retarded. That's a misuse of the term. And it's usually pejorative, and it's not that funny if you know the real story about what it is to have somebody who struggles with that kind of intellectual difficulty in their life. Doesn't make them a bad person. One of the coolest people I've met is named Paul. He lived across the street from me in Memphis. He was as happy a guy as you could ever meet. He was as friendly and helpful, and he was just a joy to be around. But he was technically in this area over here. His mom had him working at a program that allowed him to go to work every day and pick him up. He was in his 30s. They'd pick him up. He'd go do some work that he could handle, and they would send a small check home for his work, which helped her defray some of her bills and costs of care. But he needed somebody to take care of him on the grand scheme. He wasn't going to be able to pay the bills, even if he had the money. He wouldn't understand them. On this end up here, now we got people way above average. That's your gifted community in standardized public education. They get the enriched classes, which in many places include all of 1 hour a week. That's the way they deal with that. So what you see is people start to deviate from the mean so far that they become clinically of interest. On one end, you want to supply them with all kinds of resources to help them maximize what they can do. And on the other end, you want to do a similar thing where you don't have somebody who feels like they're not being, accounted for in the general curriculum because they get that, and they've got it for a long time. They get bored. They oftentimes get into trouble, all right? But now keep in mind, we still got people on this end. We still got 0.3, and they're split. So now there's 0.15 over here and 0.15 over here. Here is almost institutionalized, almost guaranteed. Somebody who really can't feed themselves, they can't clean themselves, they can't handle daily living activities because the intellectual deficiency is so profound, but it's rare. So most people with mental retardation are actually closer to this level than this level. That's something you know by the curve. And then you got people way out here who are geniuses, but they might not be good people to know. They may not be helpful people. They may not be people that or even good-hearted in any way, shape, or form. So keeping that in mind, what I pointed out to my daughter is when you're talking about any kind of issue that might arise in politics, it is by definition complex. It's complicated. Why do I know that? Because if it wasn't, it wouldn't be an issue. You tell me what an economy is. Really, what an economy is. Because I get 100 PhDs in economics to get into a room and they'll debate the definitions of the economy. Not the broad intro level definition, they'll agree there. But metrics of the economy, things that contribute to it growing or shrinking, and it's, you start talking about kind of supply and demand, services, goods, right? Trade laws, unemployment, tariffs, global issues, geopolitical situations, and it's really complicated. Now, does any politician that you know of go, you know, it's really, really complicated, it's going to be hard to figure out? Or do they say, I know what we need to do? They say, I know what we need to do. Follow me. I know what's going on. And that's really reassuring to hear that somebody knows what's going on, because most of them are going, hell, I don't know. I don't have time to look at those kinds of things, much less do I understand them intricately, and those who do understand them intricately can debate each other all day about the actual underlying forces that need to be manipulated. Whether they can be manipulated being a whole nother thing. or whether manipulating will have unintended consequences. So my point to her was this: A, when you're talking about the thing that you see clearly, keep in mind that you are gifted. You're actually able to understand some complex issues on a higher level, because what does mean at 50 on a truly normal, or a mean of 100 on a truly normal distribution actually entail? It means that by definition, 50% of the entire population of the world has an IQ less than 100. Think about it. Not a value judgment. I mean, to really understand complicated material requires an ability to think about things in a complicated way. And not everybody has been given that gift or that ability. So 1 in 2 people really don't understand it the same way that you understand it, number one. Number two, when we start looking on this side of it and way up here even, these people may be bright, but they also have worldviews. They also have schemas, and they also have political persuasions, and they also have agendas. So they use all their intellectual power not to be totally objective and fair, although they might think that they're being totally objective and fair, but because they already have some preconceived notions about what all this should mean and what they should do with that information, and that's what they're presenting to people as a foregone conclusion that everybody ought to see clearly. But everybody doesn't see it clearly. Even if they're able to see it with a complex viewpoint, their viewpoint is not unclouded by bias. And it doesn't matter which side of the political spectrum you're on. It's equally applicable because we're talking about human beings, cognitive processing, and social cognition. That should be profoundly interesting to most people in this room, because I doubt that most people have considered politics from that point of view. But that's human psychology at work. It's also at work. It's also at school. It's also at church. It's also in your family. It's also everywhere humans are. So that anytime we're talking about stuff that's really hard to understand, some people, not, in fact, about half, not saying that you can't understand things at 100 or 99, et cetera, and keeping in mind that we're talking about a score on a measure of one kind of intelligence, right? Where a confidence interval might put you over here. But when we're talking about here versus here, there are clear differences in abilities to do that without making value judgments about human worth, because that is a mistake. But it's frequently done, right? So keep that in mind. That's why stats are important. That's why it makes you a more informed citizen, because it makes you think about things differently. Critical thinking is not just a buzzword, and it's not something you do accidentally. I'm not a better thinker because I happen to be bright. Everybody in this room is bright. We've all been given that gift in one way or another, however you decide you got it, notwithstanding. Right? But what you will do with that gift depends on training. Training to think in a different way requires some kind of intervention, and in a large way, that is what college is really about.